I welcome you all in this webinar. Today's topic will be cognizance into the collision-free world of unmanned ground vehicle. We will start with the topics of discussion. We will begin with the discussion on the journey of autonomy for ground vehicles, the growth of autonomous driving in the global horizon. The agenda will further include an overview to the sensor topology that serves as the backbone for any AD feature that includes and not restricted to collision avoidance alone. We will learn the fundamentals and architecture design oriented with collision avoidance feature and explore a few case studies on to understand the implementation on a simulated platform with robotic vehicle. We will be talking about the challenges of collision avoidance in particular and the state of art revolving around its evolution so far. We will end with the future career and job opportunities with the upcoming autonomous driving technologies and its influence in the global market economy. I believe all of you will be gaining a lot of deep insights and technical knowledge into the self-driving technology, specifically under the collision avoidance feature, by the end of this webinar. So let's see how and from where all of this started in journey to autonomous driving. In the advent of road communication, human driver needs to drive vehicle. However, it needs significant manual effort and also brings forth the question of human safety as a critical factor in lieu of risking lives with increasing road accidents. So from 21st century, people started focusing on automating the manual driving. Google started with testing autonomous vehicle around 2010. And then onwards, a lot of focus has been given to research and development to launch autonomous vehicle in the market. Tesla, BMW, Volkswagen are forerunners in the field of autonomous vehicle development. Few organizations tried to establish autonomous vehicle free run, but most of them failed. For example, you might have heard about Tesla or Uber. And that led to focus on the stringent rule in development and validation of autonomous driving features prior to its market launch. So currently, most of the automotive giants are focusing on AD development from 2015 onwards, and while aiming it like 2050 plus to bring complete autonomy of road vehicles in most of the world. We will discuss about the levels of autonomy in our succeeding slides, starting from L0 to L4, then to complete autonomy at L5 level. Collision avoidance feature, as you can see in this slide, collision avoidance feature lies within L2 and L3 level, and currently most of the OEM stands to such levels in 2020. So this is one of the significant features growing rapidly in most of the in the modern world of unmanned vehicles. Here we'll be discussing about sensors. As you all know, sensors serve as the backbone of any kind of autonomous driving feature. Sensing the environment has a major role in driverless cars. It acts as the way eyes acts to the in a human body. So it is the perception unit for the vehicle system in the autonomous application. Traditionally, the sensors only included camera, radar, and ultrasonic. But as we are moving towards more perfection and enhancement and advancement of the autonomous driving feature, we are currently also introducing LiDAR. So cameras could be monocular or stereo camera. Radar could be long, medium, or short. Ultrasonic sensors are mostly used for near object sensing. LiDAR could be 2D or 3D. It's used increasingly for better detection and the enhancement of the entire algorithm, but it's also cost prohibitive. So it's currently, it's traditionally, it was not in use, but to enhance the vehicle features, people have started giving more importance to LiDAR as well. So that was the entire sensor topology. Coming on to the placement of sensors, as in how it works for a collision avoidance feature, how the sensors are being mounted. So this is a typical representation of all the sensors mounted on the vehicle body frame. This could be a sensor topology for this is a sensor topology for collision avoidance. So here, as you can see, radar sensors are used for object sensing and perceive the relative position and velocities of obstacles in its FOV. FOV as in field of view. Similarly, cameras are used for both object positioning and environment detection, including gathering road and lane information, etc. Ultrasonic sensors are generally used to perceive objects in close vicinity and mostly applicable for low speed applications. Ultrasound, as in the sonar, mostly those sensors. LiDAR is a laser-based sensor and gives us a point cloud reflection from the surrounding area and is useful for accurate position measurement and implemented at high-level, high-end autonomy levels. When we talk about the perception system, the entire sensors mounted on the vehicle, what it actually does is it senses the environment around it. So what actually consists inside the environment? This surrounding traffic obstacles, whatever is there in the environment around us, that plays a huge role in how the vehicle performance will be after the implementation of the algorithm inside the vehicle. On what factors it will be dependent on is actually related to the surrounding view, the surrounding of the environment. So there could be four-wheelers like car or passenger vehicles, commercial vehicles, trucks, etc. There could be two-wheelers like bike, cycle, etc. And there could be other environment road objects like traffic cones, traffic signs, traffic lights, road barriers, adjacent lane drivers, dividers, etc. So all of these play a huge role in the perception, in how the features are going to work in an autonomous driving feature, like in an autonomous driving vehicle. When we talk about collision avoidance in particular, this flow diagram, as you can see here, this flow diagram represents the interface of collision avoidance feature. So the sensing unit is the input and the actuation unit is the output. So how the collision avoidance strategy works, that there could be actually three strategies inside that collision avoidance feature. There could be three methods or three strategies by virtue of which it operates. So there could be first method, which we will be discussing in detail in the succeeding slides. So the first strategy is longitudinal control. Longitudinal control is mostly dependent on the brakes of my ego vehicle. Throughout this webinar, I'll be mentioning ego vehicle and ego lane a lot. So basically, ego vehicle means my vehicle where all the control features are there, the autonomous vehicle which I'll where the algorithm is actually working is the ego vehicle, which is my vehicle, which is a driverless car like that, where the collision avoidance feature is implemented. So ego vehicle, in whichever lane the ego vehicle is running, that lane will be called as ego lane and the vehicle will be called as ego vehicle. So in case ego vehicle gets into the longitudinal, so ego vehicle for the collision avoidance feature can get into the longitudinal control or lateral control or a composite longitudinal and lateral motion. So longitudinal control basically is dependent on the braking functionality of the vehicle. It could be speed reduction braking or it could be mitigation braking. While the lateral maneuver, it more or less is dependent on the steer system of the vehicle. So there could be lane change or there could be emergency steer. When we combine both the features and we involve both longitudinal and lateral features and we include both braking as well as steer, there comes the composite longitudinal and lateral motion control that will involve both braking and steer. So it could be comfort braking and steer, or it could be emergency braking and steer. So how the collision avoidance features, what kind of challenges when we look into the feature itself, what could be the major challenges? So major challenges of a robotic system, any robotic system, lies in the sensing associated with environment and actuation system associated with vehicle dynamics. So some of the critical challenges involves motion during road transition, like straight to curvature roads. Then there could be traffic in the vicinity of ego vehicle. There could be unpredictable motion of traffic vehicle, like lack of free space in crowded traffic. Or there could be some different kind of traffic models, like there could be a highly aggressive vehicle or high-speed traffic or a slow-moving vehicle, static vehicle. All of these kind of traffic characterizations play a very major role in, it plays a threat to my vehicle, which comes as a challenge to the collision avoidance feature. From traffic, if next challenge could be uncertainty and inconsistency in sensing. So there could be sensor noise, obstacle information, inconsistency in the lane or road environment information. And finally, there could be non-linearity in the actuation system. So if you can see this diagram, in the upper half of this diagram, there's inconsistency in sensing in terms of high-speed traffic. So there could be chances of collision with high-speed traffic due to position inaccuracy at longer distances. Like if this is a very high-speed traffic and my vehicle has to sense the high-speed traffic, there could be inconsistency in sensing. And because of that inconsistency in sensing, there are high risk of collision of my vehicle with the vehicle in front. Similarly, coming down to this diagram, what challenge or what could be the risk factor here? So you can see there are a lot of road transitions, curvature and straight roads, etc. So chances of collision increases with the road boundaries due to non-linearity of actuation, especially at road curvatures. See, for example, at hill stations. So at hill stations, there are a lot of curvature roads, a lot of curvy roads are there. So at that point of time, if my actuation system, actuation means the brake pedal or the steer, if that is not working, if there's a dead zone, if when I have applied the brake, it didn't work at the same time or it's lagging, there's a delay, there's a dead zone, then in that case, there are high risks of collision of my vehicle at the with the road boundaries, like it may go outside the road. There could be high risk of collision in those situations, in case there are road transitions or there's non-linearity in the actuation system, etc. So these are all the challenges of collision avoidance, and we, as in when we work on such kind of autonomous driving feature, these are all the factors which must be taken into consideration before implementing it or while testing it. All of these challenges are considered before we implement it into the vehicle. Let's see how the collision avoidance feature works in the entire autonomous driving architecture. So as you can see in this entire flow diagram, collision avoidance lies right here, like in the lower right side. This block, one of these blocks is collision avoidance. So it interacts with all the other blocks of the entire autonomous driving, in entire autonomous driving architecture. So it all starts with the sensors, okay? So there are two categories of sensors. There could be vehicle sensors or there could be perception sensors. So vehicle sensors are like odometer, IMU, etc. Perception sensor could be LiDAR, radar, camera, etc. Initially, after getting the sensed, the perception signals inside the vehicle, what the autonomous vehicle feature does is it plans a path. Like it does a route planning from source to destination. Based on the road information from digital map, there will be a global planning from source to destination that will be under this global planner feature. So after the global planner, there will be motion compensation. The ego vehicle, which is my vehicle, will compensate vehicle position based on yaw rate, vehicle speed, etc. Post the motion compensation, there will be localization. Localization means position correction of ego vehicle. After the localization, there will be a local planner which will interact with both the local localization and the collision avoidance. So it should plan a path which will take into consideration this global planning, motion compensation, localization, and at the same time should interact with the collision avoidance. So it should make sure that there's no risks of collision while planning the path. So once that kind of path is planned, then it will get into the motion control, which is the final thing, where which means now it will apply brake or do the engine control or do the steer control, etc. So that will come under motion control. So if we discuss about collision avoidance in particular, specifically how it works, so this is how it works. This is the process flow for collision avoidance. So it all starts with HMI. HMI as in human-machine interaction. Through HMI user input, the driver will interact. So here the user is basically the driver. The driver will interact with the vehicle system for the desired functionality. Here the desired functionality is collision avoidance. After the user interaction has been done with the HMI, there will be situation analysis. In situation analysis, there will be, like, situation analysis will consist of surrounding drive space estimation, road traffic identification, etc. Once the situation around the vehicle surroundings has been done, there will be obstacle and risk classification. So there could be obstacles like there could be risk zones, like some obstacle may be a low risk, may pose low risk, some may lie under low risk, medium risk, high risk. So they could be categorized in terms of risk classification. There could be risk classification, they could, depending on what kind of obstacles are there in the vicinity of my ego vehicle, there will be a risk classification. Once the risk classification is done, local path planning for collision-free movement will be based on such parameters like vehicle speed, acceleration, jerk, situation analysis, and risk classification. So with all these parameters, there will be a local path planning. So we will generate an optimized path based on the cost function output of these parameters and perform finally the speed maneuver, like the control, depending on whatever the cost function has been developed. Like we had developed an optimized path based on all such parameters. Post the development of that kind of path with respect to collision avoidance, we will give controls to the vehicle system. Like we will have brake, steer, or engine that will take over the control, and it will be implemented in the vehicle body. In terms of major components of collision avoidance, we just discussed surrounding obstacle detection. So how the obstacles, what kind of obstacles will be there around the vehicle, and how many sensors are there, and how the sensors perceive the environment around it. That is one of the major components and that we just discussed. Now, the next part, which is the path planning, on what terms those path planning feature, that path planning is based on. So there could be many strategies in terms of how the path will be planned. But mostly I'll be discussing two major strategies which we use in the path planning. So there could be polynomial based path planning, which is based on the kinematic equations. By kinematic equation, I mean any kind of mathematical expressions, like algebraic expressions, any kind of kinematic equations. There could be polynomial-based path planning, or there could be geometry-based path planning, which is based on symmetry structure. So here, like this curve is symmetrical to this curve. So any kind of geometry-based path planning, which is based on symmetry structure. So these are two kind of strategies for path planning. Once the path planning is done, we must ensure that the vehicle is following that kind of path. So for that, we need controllers. We can have many kind of controllers. We can have conventional PID controllers or model predictive controller, optimal control, non-linear adaptive control. So PID controller design is basically based on the conventional control philosophy and system stability principles. While a model predictive controller is based on receding horizon and optimization technique. So it depends on the user, the application, how are the requirements. On the basis of that, these things are planned. Now move on to the vehicle arrangement for autonomous feature development. So how basically these things works in a real world vehicle system. So how it works is we have all these sensors. So it needs to somehow communicate with the vehicle feature. Like whatever the sensor has detected in the surrounding environment, that should communicate with my vehicle. And that communication works through these Ethernet CAN protocols. Once the ADAS ECU both works with the input sensors, and then based on those input and the algorithm inside the vehicle, like it will work on the outputs through the EPS ECU or the brake ECU. So basically, like a powertrain ECU is engine torque control. The brake ECU is the brake pressure control. EPS ECU is a steering torque control, and instrument cluster is a vehicle cluster HMI information or speedometers. So once the algorithm has been processed and the work has been done from the inside the vehicle, it has to work, and how it works in the vehicle body are through these kind of ECUs. So this communication works. This is the communication way, like how the algorithm communicates with the sensors, the inputs, and how it implements it in the vehicle body through the output. That is being depicted here. So let's understand the collision avoidance through some scenarios and through some examples, how it works in the to understand it more deeply through some visual diagrams. We'll try to understand how in a particular scenario collision avoidance will come into picture and how it will work. So say for example, this green vehicle is my ego vehicle, which is my vehicle where the feature is working. This is a traffic vehicle. The yellow vehicle is a traffic vehicle. And the red vehicle is another traffic vehicle, which is an adjacent lane. This yellow traffic vehicle is an ego lane. And this red traffic vehicle is in an adjacent lane. So what happens here is, say for example, ego vehicle is traveling at a speed of 50 kmph and it anticipates collision with a static vehicle. So this vehicle is basically a static vehicle. So at this point of time, when this vehicle is moving at a 50 kmph speed and it anticipates some kind of collision risks with this vehicle, the yellow traffic vehicle, then it should the collision avoidance feature should get activated and it should function. So what it does is it applies brake. It gets into, so if you remember, I spoke about two kind of strategies, longitudinal control and lateral. So here, longitudinal action takes place, longitudinal control takes place. Why it doesn't go to lateral? Lateral means there should be some, like this is longitudinal, which is in the ego lane direction, and whatever is in the adjacent lane direction is the lateral control. So here, because in the adjacent lane, there's already another vehicle, another slowly moving vehicle, while saving my ego vehicle from one traffic vehicle, it may get into the risk of colliding with another traffic vehicle. So I cannot get into another lane. So there will not be any lateral movement. There will be longitudinal movement, and that's why it will apply brake. So say for example, it may apply a brake of 5 m/s² to maintain a safety distance from anticipated collision point. Say it may anticipate that towards the edge of the traffic vehicle, it may collide, may detect any kind of collision point, and it will keep a safety distance, and then it will apply brake, maintaining that kind of safety distance.